गुड मॉर्निंग,
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग स्पिन,
या कंटिन्यू ऑन।
ओके, सो गाइस, इज जस्ट अ काइंड ऑफ स्मॉल रीकैप ऑन ऑल द कॉन्सेप्ट दैट वी हैव डिस्कस्ड टिल नाउ। आई एम लीविंग अपार्ट द थ्योरेटिकल पार्ट दैट वी डिस्कस्ड ऑन प्लेटफॉर्म इंडिपेंडेंट जेवीएम जेआरई जेडीके एंड ऑल। सो वी स्टार्टेड विद वेरिएबल, you can comment guys, we started with variable and then we discussed defining data type of a variable. There are many: numeric, char, string, boolean. String we haven't yet discussed, boolean majorly we'll use this one only. Even in numeric we have
integer,
float,
double,
long,
okay, byte, and then we discuss data operations,
arithmetic.
Logical,
arithmetic is
plus minus
division into okay. Next, logical. What are logical?
Double and not.
Okay.
Double or.
Okay. Good guys.
Logical not.
Logical.
And then after logical,
binary operator.
Okay, relational operator. What are relational operators?
Less than, greater than, equal to.
Less than or equal to?
Greater than equal to.
Okay, greater than equal to. Okay. And what are increment operators? Plus.
Minus.
And then we used data conditions. What are data conditions?
If and switch.
Switch.
Yeah. In if.
If else.
We have.
Only if.
Only if.
If else.
Nested if.
Ladder if. I hope you guys all practice this, guys. Okay. See, yes. These are very simple, and every now and then you will be using. Like, see, when you get a requirement and to write a small program, all the time you will be thinking about this only, guys. Where to use if condition? Where to use for loop? Where to use while loop? Where should I use do while loop? And how? See, these are the basics. With the help of these basics, and if you apply your logical sense, you will be able to crack any kind of program. Some programs will be very tough, but believe me, if you think through any program, you will be able to easily crack it. Okay. We finish the conditions, and then after conditions, we started discussing about loops. So, what are the different loops that we discussed?
While, do while.
What is the difference? While and do while. While checks the condition goes inside the statement.
Yeah.
Do while with or without fail, whether the condition, it, even without checking the, wait, someone is waiting there. So it, okay. Okay. Do while, first it will execute it and then it will start checking the condition. So at any point of time, if you go with do while, one time execution will be passed, okay, and then it will check the condition. If it fails, then it will come out of that. Okay, while is done, do while is done. Now then is for loop. for loop and extended loop. Okay. In operators, we missed one thing, ternary operators. I guess Harsha has done some good example on the ternary operator as well. Ternary operator. I'll explain this ternary operator today. Okay. Loops. So this is what we discussed, guys. So we came here. So we started with variable. From the variable, we started what kind of data type do we need to define for a variable and what to define, whether it is inflow, double, and then what kind of operations that we can perform with this variable, whether we can go ahead with defining two variables and doing arithmetic operations, logical operations, and relations, and then ternary operator. I'll just explain it in a while. And then we went to data conditions and we seen the if statements and then switch cases, you know, when the data is not sure, then probably we'll take that value and we'll, based on our assumptions, maybe it can be case 0, it can be case 1, it can be case 2. Similarly, if you take the string value, and the string value, you can just see that, you know, case chendu, if it is the string inputted is as in chendu, what to do? If it is in something else, what to do? Switch casement we can use in such scenarios, and then if there are any conditions that we need to validate, we always go by if conditions. Then, you know, if there are any repetitive statements that we need to perform, instead of writing 100 lines of code, we'll rely on loops to perform all these repetitive operations. Okay, thereby we'll get into a major topic called arrays. We'll see the loops, and then the next topic would be arrays. Till now, I'll just give a brief description of array. Till now, in a variable, let's say int a, we're storing the number, single digit or double digit, only one number, right? You guys following?
Yeah.
If it is a string,
yes.
If it is a string, str, we are gonna use what is that? Chendu. Only one value, right? In case a variable has to hold multiple values, let's 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's a simple example. We'll see, guys. Let's take Harsha. His marks. What is his marks? Is like 95, 90, 89, 75. Okay, this is his marks, 88, 87. See, simply like this is his marks out of all the 5 subjects. Instead of just making as like a int subject 1 equal to 95, int subject 2 equal to 90. So instead of making it you know, line by line, declaring one variable for one to hold one subject marks, let us say simply makes it like marks, which is of int kind of array. So the syntax to declare array is like this. What is the array equal to 95. Let's copy. Simple, guys. Array concept is very simple as long as you understand the basics of it. That's it. Instead of just putting a single value in a variable, okay, we are putting multiple values in a variable. That variable will be considered as, or will be called as, an array. An array which will store multiple values. Clear, guys?
Yes.
Till now, we're only discussing like putting a value inside a variable, single value, be it string, be it int, be it float, be it or any other data type, which were only single value we're storing in a variable. Till now, that is what we discussed and we studied. Now, we are introducing a concept called arrays, which will hold multiple values in a single variable. Right? Any questions, guys, here? Anyways, we'll discuss this later and we'll see the example also. But I just wanted you to introduce to array now itself. You guys, any questions?
We can give one. I am having one question, Chandu sir. We can give a float also in CD, sir.
We can give float also. Any data type. Okay. Any data type. See, usually like if you go by percentages, it will be like 90.5%, 96.3%, something we'll get. While we're storing the percentages, we will definitely have to declare it as a float or double. Correct? So yes. Any data type, we can, in a variable, if you wanted to keep a repeated multiple values, we'll easily go for arrays. Okay. Now I can say, okay, now you say, here it is very clear. Int subject 1 is 91. Int mark subject 2 is 91. So how do I plug out? How do I pick out the X only 98? It's simple, guys. See, here, this position is 0 position. This position is 1st position. This position is 3rd position. This stands in 4th position. This stands in 5th position. Okay. If I have to get 1st marks, all I need to do is marks marks of 0. What will I get?
95.
Simple. 95. Marks of 0 is 95 because at 0th place, 95 is there. What is the total length of this marks? If I say marks dot length, what is the total length? It is how many are there? We have 5. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But count starts from 0. Okay. Mm-hmm. Index start from 0. We have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. That's it. 5 variables. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That is the reason length is 5. But that index will start with 0. So 95, 0 position, 95 is there. First position, 90 is there. Number 3 position, 89 is there. 4 position, 75 is there. 5th position, 87 is there. You understood, guys, arrays?
Yes.
It's very simple, guys. Very simple. Because most of the, our solutions will be through arrays only, okay? Though we use single value holding variable also, but majority of the cases we'll deal with arrays, okay? This is just a small brief introduction to arrays. Fine, guys?
Yes.
So can someone tell me what is an array?
Which holds a multiple values
in a variable, in a single variable, okay?
Yes. So can we store strings?
You can store strings also. Okay. That's what I said, any data type, okay? Okay. Any data type, any data type. We have lots and lots of examples, guys, over the net. Okay, we don't need to, you don't need to just do the, exercises, which I'm only giving on the class, in the class. Okay, there are lot of examples out there in Google. Depend on Google and keep practicing. Take one example and keep practicing. Yesterday, I was just going through and this anyways, we'll discuss printing stars, from a pyramid structure. I thought of taking it to normal for loop example. So we'll discuss for and we'll come back to ternary operators. Okay.
Okay.
So let's come back to yesterday. So you guys are clear with while and do while, right?
Yes.
Everyone, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So let's do a small example. For is simple, guys. For is very simple. So for. Come here. Okay. For first is initialization. For in open the brace, first thing you are going to do is initialization. Second, condition. Next, increment. Increment or
decrement.
Okay. Followed by
Statements
inside the for loop. Simple. That's it. First, what you are going to do, I'll declare a variable and I'll initialize it. Int i int I equal to 0. Then I'll do the condition. I
less than or equal to.
Less than or equal to maybe 5. Okay. If I'm doing 5, I'll increment it by 1. I plus plus. Okay. Here statement SOP print my I. Okay. Print I. Guys, please mute yourself. Will be disturbance for your remaining people. Okay. Thank you. So print. See, this is the very simple syntax for for. So here what we are doing from 0 to 5, we are just printing one by one. Yesterday we did with keeping commas, and we did it with while statement, right? Now yes. The same thing we can do it with for statement also. First statement is very simple. It will always contain three positions. First position, increment it. In the second position, condition check. In the third, first position, initialization. First position, initialization. In the second position, condition. In the third position, increment it. That's it. It will loop itself. How many times the condition is getting passed, it will loop. And then whatever the statements inside that, it will execute. Let's say after three, here what, tell me like how many, what all values will be printed here?
0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
But after 3, I wanted to come out. I don't want it to print. I do not want to print after 3. Simple, guys. First, what I'll do? Now I'll go to if condition, right?
Yes.
If I equal to 3. Okay. If I equal to 3. What will I do? Break. Remember, guys, we discussed this on switch, right?
Yes.
Break. It will just come out from the for loop. Okay, I'm checking here. If I becomes 3, here I'm printing SOP print I. Okay, this is my simple for loop, guys. 0 to 5 values, I just wanted to print. I've been printing so far successfully, but someone told me suddenly like, no, I don't want to print. Though you loop it for 5 times, but only three variables, only I need to print. So what happens? It will come inside the loop. I is 0. Okay. It will go for a print. Next it will again loop. I will increment here. Correct?
Yes.
I gets increment here. Second time it will come into loop. I equal to 3, which will fail. It will come down and print that I. Then again, it will go back. Whenever the loop is starting, what will happen? Increment will start pick up, right? If you do the increment, that will get increment. I will get increment. If you do the decrement, I value will get decrement. So again, for the third time, if it is coming back, so it will, I will get increment. Now it will come back. Okay, if I equal to 3. Now what happens? Break. No, we don't want to continue. We don't want to continue. Are we coming out of if loop or are we coming out of if condition or are we coming out of for loop?
For loop.
Coming out of the if condition.
No, there is nothing that we coming out of if condition. You are breaking the for loop, not the if condition. If condition, we are already checking it here, right? Whether it will be true or false. The condition is already checking. But if you write a break statement, you are coming out of the for loop.
Yes.
To come out of a loop, what do you use?
Break.
To come out of a loop, you use break. Okay, guys, clear?
Yes.
Let us do this simple thing here. for int I equal to 0, I less than or equal to 5, I plus plus. Here, sysout. See, what is the difference between print and println, guys?
Print will be same line.
Println is a new line.
Okay. N. Sorry, not N. I. Okay. I'm just running this. Till now here, we are clear. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, someone asked me, no, just print till 3 and you come out. I don't want to go ahead from there. Break it from 3. Break it at 3. So what I'll do, I'll just add. Now, see, it depends on your logical sense. Here, I can apply if condition. Okay? That's what you need to, someone's told you immediately, like you break it from there. Okay, what should I do now? Now I should, when it is 3, I should come out. So when you think that you need to check the condition at 3, the immediate thing that you need to strike in your mind is, okay, let's put a if condition here. If I equal to 3, okay, what am I going to do? Come out, break that. So if I run this program, 0, 1, 2. Okay. So on the 3 condition, it came out, right?
Yes.
So the 3 did not printed, because when this condition becomes successful, we break the loop. We broke the loop. Right, guys? Following?
Yes.
Yeah. So you need to know where to write the for loop, where to apply the if condition, and where exactly you can break the loop also. Okay?
Yeah, can you again say the difference between print and println? I didn't get that.
See, print, so now you are seeing it print, right?
Yes.
Print will print in the same line. Okay? If you type println, just see the difference. Cursor will go to the next line.
Okay.
0, 1, 2, right? Cursor will go to next line. Okay?
Yeah.
That's a simple for loop. Also, let us take, I have taken one small example of this, guys. Do you remember nested if?
Yes.
Nested for now. Okay?
Yeah, okay.
Nested for. See, you can loop if for inside a for inside a for, that depends on your logical capabilities. Okay, now here what I'm doing is I declared two variables, okay, int n I j, and then I say like rows. Okay, rows. Okay, now as I said, I need to print that stars. So let's say like first for loop I have started. For I equal to 0, I less than or equal to rows. Rows, what value it is holding? 5. So it checks the condition 5 and then it starts incrementing. So I came here. From outer loop, I came to inner loop. Inner loop to handle the columns now. Okay. Now it comes to this loop. There again, I have written one more for loop actually. Here it is I. Right here, it is I. Here it is j. So for j equal to 0, j less than or equal to I value. What is I here? 0. So I'm taking I from the for loop. I'm checking I from the for loop and I'm incrementing the j. And then I've started printing the star here. Okay. On each for loop, this is ending. I'm going to next loop. Okay, now let's see this program. Maybe we'll go by debugging, guys. Let's debug the program, then only you will understand it. Multiple for loops. Where is it? It's not. Yes, who? Please mute yourself. Whoever is not talking, please mute yourself. Okay, I'll go to debug and switching. So what button should I press now to go line by line?
F6.
Okay. I came here. Int I equal to 0. I initialized I with zero. Okay. Int before itself I have declared, guys. I have not declared here int. Before itself, I declared int I and j, and then inside the for loop, I started initializing the value. Okay. For I equal to 0, I less than rows is 5. I how much? 0. Correct? Now it comes here. It entered into the first second for loop. Now it goes inside that. Now j is 0. I is 0. Will this this condition? J less than or equal to I.
Yes.
Satisfied. 0 less than or equal to 0. Satisfied, yes. Right?
Yes.
Now, I just printed a star now. Okay? Now, still, see, why did cursor did not went to the top for loop? This is bit, tricky, guys. Can someone answer that? Okay. I'll say. See, now we are talking about for loop inside a for loop, right? We are talking about for, okay, some statements here. Statement one. Statement 2, statement 3, sorry, not this one, so tell me, guys, when will this for loop completely ends?
Once the condition fails.
Okay, int I equal to 0, I less than or equal to 5, I plus. Okay, this will, you are clear up till here, right? It will loop for 5 times. Whatever inside this conditions and statements are there, those statements, each statement will be executed for 5 times. Okay, right? Until you use break, until you forcibly come out of that loop condition, it will loop for the number of times that you have defined in the condition. You all will agree it, right?
Yes.
So that is the same thing I'm doing it here. Now, there's a for loop in top. Okay? I have created a for loop here again. See, I have created a for loop here. So, first, once it enters into the child for loop, this for loop will completely run, right?
Yes.
Okay, it will completely run as many until this condition fails. This for loop will keeps on executing. Okay, once this is over, then it will go to next loop in the top for loop. Getting it, guys?
Yes.
It is always executing one for loop only at a time. From parent, we went to child for loop. It completes the child for loop. See, one loop we entered from the parent. One step we took from the here. Here we took one step. And then we entered here. But here in the conditions, it should repeat it. It should complete it, right? This entire for loop. Once it completes, okay. It's as simple as this statement, guys. As simple as this is the statement. So statement one is for loop for now for us. Okay. Again, since it is a for loop, again, it has its own conditions. Again, it is repeating there. It's closing. So here now, just come back here. Now let's see. F6, I went. Why did it came out? I is still zero only. See here, I is still zero. J already incremented by one, right? When J is zero, we printed star. When J is zero, we printed star. J is incremented now. J becomes one. See this condition? Will this condition satisfy now?
No,
because J one is less one less than now. One less than or equal to zero. It came out. Okay. Now I'm going to next line. See now.
Okay.
Now first star is printed now. Now again I'm going now. Now which one is incremented? See the top right corner, guys. I is now becomes one. The yellow line you are seeing, right?
Yes.
I is now becomes one. Earlier loop, I was zero.
Zero.
Correct? Earlier loop.
Yes.
This is slightly tricky, but if you concentrate, you will easily understand it. Okay? First for loop, I was zero. It entered inside that, and then program found one more for loop. Okay. Then its second for loop started executing. It started executing all the statements inside the child for loop. Once it does that, it came out. Now that for loop is again repeating. Main for loop, it's still main for loop, still the conditions are there, right?
Yes.
I less than rows. Rows, how much we have given?
Five.
That means irrespective of child working or not working, parent for loop has to repeat it for 5 times. For now, how much time it has repeated? Only one time with value 0. Now I becomes 1. Now come here. Second time again it entered. Again for loop will execute, right?
Yes.
See, as system.out.println is executing, for loop also execute with every iteration. Simple. Right? See here. Now let's see. F6. J become. Now, what is the value of J?
1.
Let's see. J becomes 0. Why? Can someone answer? Why J becomes 0? Anyone?
It enters into the second loop. That is for J is equal to 0.
Correct. Let's see. I completed main for loop. Okay. I came out and I'm done with the for loop. Once I'm done with the for loop, what will be the value of I? That for loop is completed, right?
Yes.
That is done. Similarly, inside the for loop, there is J. This loop is already completed. In the first iteration of I, let's take it, this one is I for, this is J for. In the first iteration of I, J did some operations and then J completed. This entire for loop is completed. And then again, when we entered into second iteration of I, the I becomes one, but this will start freshly, right? Again from the beginning.
Okay.
Again, J, I'm initializing with 0. Again, I'm initializing with 0. Do you all agree this will repeat for the freshly?
Yes.
For the second time? When the first it is starting, what is the initialization? J becomes 0, right? We're initializing zero. It.
Yes.
Okay.
When this is running freshly, again, initialization happens, right?
Yes.
So J becomes 0, J less than or equal to I. Now see what happens. It printed star now. I value is still 1. Remember, guys?
Yes.
I iteration, we are still on second round. Correct?
Yes.
J iteration. Now it is inside one. J. One is completed. Again, J becomes now one.
Yes.
Okay. Wait. J becomes now one. What is I? I is already one. Again, yes. It will. This condition will match, right? This condition, yes, will match.
Yes.
Again, I'm printing star.
Okay.
Now see here, in the console output, star star came.
Yes.
Okay. The condition failed. Why? J is incremented again. J becomes two. Here, J becomes two. And I is still one, because I is in the first iteration only. J finished its complete iteration. J for loop has completed its complete iteration because this condition has already failed. You're following it, guys?
Yes.
Yes.
So now I'm printing. I'm moving out to next line. Right? Here, one star I printed, two stars I printed, and I'm moving out from the next line. My third loop started prime. Now I becomes two. Now tell me, guys, for loop will start from freshly or it will pick up from the old one?
It will start freshly from J equal to zero and then
exactly. If you understand that, you guys are clear. Okay. Because earlier, in the earlier loop, it's completed. Again, now how many times that J will repeat, this J for loop will be done?
Until it is less than or equal to 5.
Five.
Then or equal to I.
What is the I value? 2. We're in third iteration for I, right? I value is 2. That means J will run for three times. Correct? Three times I'll print the star. Getting it, guys?
Yes.
Now see how many times? One time star. My I value is till 2. J now 0, it becomes 1. Condition still satisfies, goes inside. One more star gets printed. And again, for loop is executing because the condition is still valid. The condition is still valid. Now J is 2. Sorry, J is 1. It increments by 2 now. It increments by 2. 2 less than or equal to 2. Condition is still valid. It prints one more star. Now, J becomes 3. Is 3 less than or equal to 2?
No.
It came out.
Yes.
That one more line I went now. Again, now I'll just quickly run it. 2, 3, 4. Okay. Now tell me, guys, what is the I value now?
5.
Okay. Check the I value.
No, it fails.
4. Now we are incrementing. We are doing it post increment. Now see, I value is 4. Yes. Right? No, the length of the I value is 5, guys. Total length is 5. What we have given is it will loop for 5 times, but it starts from 0.
Okay.
0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Which is 5 times it is looping it, right? It's not starting. Here, we have not initialized with 1. We have initialized with 0. We are checking it rows. That means 0 to 5. Sorry, yes. 0, 5 values, which is starting from 0. It is 4 only, right? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Becomes 5. Correct? Now see. Now again, for inside the inner loop, will start freshly. J becomes again 0. Now I is 4. So 0 to 4, 5 times J will run. Run. J less than or equal to I, condition failed. Println, top for loop also finished, came out. Our program is completed. What happened, guys? There is print drop silence. Confused?
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, these things, you will have to practice it. Till now, we are at one stage only. See, for first loop, I equal to 0. Simply, we are checking I less than rows, I plus plus. That iteration will keeps on continue for until this value i is less than 5. It keeps on for 5 times. Okay, that there it, we are fine, right? Till there we are fine. Now when we entered into second loop, see here, if you understand one thing, main for loop I am using it for rows. 1,
okay,
2, 3, 4, 5, right? The inside for loop I am using it for columns. See here, how many times that it has executed? 1 star. Again it executed 2 stars. Columns, for columns I am using it for j. In a table, if you take it in a matrix, if you take, you will have that rows and columns, right? To define a rows, I am taking the first for loop. That's why I have given for 5. So I need to have 5. Let's say if I simply give it as a 10. See, main for loop, this condition I am giving it for 10 rows, and then the second for loop. The tricky part is, guys, just if you observe this j condition, I am checking with the I value. J less than or equal to I. Why am I doing this? Can someone tell me?
We are checking with the rows.
Correct. Not with the rows. That rows condition will be executed on the primary, top for loop only.
Yes.
I need to derive to the columns. How many times that I need to print? Because this particular things depends on the I. See here, I, now initially when it is 0, it all depends on your program, guys. Because first line, you need to print 1 star. Second line, you need to print 2 stars. Third line, you need to print 3 stars, and fourth line, you need to print 4, and fifth line, you need to print 5 stars. That is clear, right, for you?
Yeah.
Because someone will give you the output to print the stars like this. So by looking at that, you need to understand, okay, first is okay. Second, you need to come with 2 stars. Third, you need to come with 3 stars. 4, you need to come with 4, and 5, you need to come with 5. So just by thinking of it, is it directly or indirectly depending on I value?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
These many times, I is anyways iterating it, right? Iterating there. So why can't we make use of I for J? So in order to print star, I'm checking my J condition with I. So that is the reason J less than or equal to I value. Initially, I is 0. Okay, I'll print for one time. One time it will execute. Now I becomes 1, which means 0, 1. So then I'll print 2 times. Then I becomes 2, which is 0, 1, 2. That is the reason it becomes 3 times. Okay. It will still be confusing, guys. As long as you run it on your own, you will not understand it. Okay.
Yeah. Will the output be same if we start with I equal to 1 and J equal to 1 and all the conditions are same?
Which one? You run it?
Yeah. I equal to 1 and J equal to 1. Just this change.
Yeah.
Will it be the same then?
It started from how many rows we get?
9.
See? 9 we get. Because index always starts from 0. Let's say, if you say rows minus 1. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. No.
8.
Here we should see rows plus 1. Sorry. Because again, it comes back to
10.
Because here index is for loop. Index will always, while you are iterating, it will always take it from the index race. It will start from the 0. Okay. Yes. If you wanted to start from 1, then you do the value of 2 plus 1. Okay? Understood?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So this is about for loop, guys. So I have one more. Let's see. Like I want to print. I'll give you one exercise. I just want to print. Fibonacci. You guys are known Fibonacci series.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. That's 0, 1, 1, and 0 plus 1, 1, 1, 2, 1 plus 1, 2, 1 plus 2, 3. 2 plus 3, 5, 5, 5, and 3, 5, 5 plus 3, 8. Okay. Similar to that, I need to print how many values came? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Let's say 13, 21, 9, right? 21, so what is the value? 4, 34.
34.
9.
10. 10 values. 10 values. I need to, up till 10 values, I need to print the Fibonacci series, right? Guys, yes. I need program for it. Please note it down for tomorrow's class. Program for
Fibonacci series.
So once, if you define for inside for, or if you define for while inside for, or for inside while, you can play around. As you can play around because you have editor, you have Java, you do the play arounds. You apply different single program according to my mathematical capability. I'll write in a way. According to your mathematical capability, you will write in a different way. Single program can be written in different manners by different by applying different logics. Okay, it can be written in many ways. You can define a string, you can define an int, or you can define a float. You can, based on data types or based on conditions, you can write in many ways according to your thinking capabilities. So don't think that if you need to follow the same path that someone else has followed. Okay, the way he written is right and the way you written is wrong. Don't ever consider it like that. Because there will be many ways in order to achieve output. The only thing is code should be readable and you should not have any errors. Whatever the output that client has asked, you should be able to print that output. Okay? You do this, guys. You keep printing the star on your own, write your own logic, and then only you will understand it. Okay? For inside a for loop. Clear, guys?
Okay.
So tomorrow you guys gonna write it for Fibonacci series. Fibonacci series, you guys are going to write it. Right? Any questions?
Yeah. Chandu sir, actually, I'm having one question.
Yeah,
Before that, you said for inside for, you can give if for breaking the loop. For instead of if, I can I give a while or do while?
Of course, you can. Let's see, but if you give break inside a while, where will you come out? You'll come out from the while loop.
Okay.
To come out from a if condition, you don't need break. Okay. To come out from a for our looping statements, you will use break.
Okay. Okay.
Understood, right? There, yes. Inside the if condition, I have given break. Break will not apply for if condition. If I use break, whatever the immediate looping that you are doing, let's say you use for loop, again you use while loop. So basically, how many loops you are giving?
Two loops.
One is, yeah, parent loop, another is
child loop.
If, yeah, you write a break inside a child loop, that in immediate loop, whatever it is, like whether it is child or parent, if you write a break inside a child loop will be terminated.
Okay.
Similarly, okay. If I write a break here, this for loop, I'll come out of this for loop, not this for loop.
Okay.
Understood.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it. So that is the thing we discussed now. This is quite tricky part. Now we completed for loop also. I think we are majorly completed a single variable things and all. Do while, for loop, extended for loop. This thing is there, right? Extended for loop. Maybe I'll do one thing. Extended for loop, I'll tell you while we're discussing on arrays. Okay, so arrays also we have seen a small introduction, right? Yes. Arrays we have seen a small introduction, right?
Yes.
If I wanted to display a group of values, immediately the choice for me would be
arrays.
Array is a variable where we can store multiple values. Okay. You want to simply run a program for array today? Let us simply run a program and we'll close it. So, array will be always be specified with what, guys? This brace. Okay? This brace. Okay? Now, let's say, for me, I'll take int. Int array. Okay? Int array. Let's take marks only. Marks. That is reference variable. That variable name. Equal to. Now, the values, I'll define it in the curly braces. 98, 95, 90, 85, 80. See here now. Sys out. Let me print marks. Not like this one. Let's say marks dot. See, automatically it is giving you guys marks. It automatically identified it as an array. As soon as if I type marks dot, it says that what are the available methods for it. Length. How much it will print now?
Five.
What is it? Okay. Five. Okay. Now I wanted to print. Marks of zero. What is the value now?
98.
5 and 98.
Simple, guys. Simple. 3.
85.
Okay. 85. Now tell me this. 5. What will be the output?
5.
There will be only 5. Output 5.
Only 5.
Marks of 5. What is only 5?
There is no 5.
It will only because print the length.
Someone said there is no
value for
value. Exactly. Yes. Who's that?
Indira.
Super Indira. There is no value, right, guys?
Yes.
Index started with 0. This is 0. 1, 2, 3, 4. See, 5 value is not there. What will I get now? Someone also said the answer. Index or something, someone said. Who is, what is that?
It will only print the length.
Index is always start from 0.
It will throw an error, guys. In array index out of bound.
Yes.
Okay. You had given a value which is not in the array. Which is not in the scope of the array. Array only consists this array marks that you have declared. The array marks that you have declared only consist of 0 to 4 values only. But you have chosen something called 5, which is not in the scope.
Out of scope.
So it thrown an error. By default, there is an error class, exception class in Java. As soon as it throws an error, Java will identify it and throws an that respect you error. See, if you don't see this array out of bounds exception, you'll not be able to easily understand it, right? You'll keep on thinking why it's not coming out.
Yes.
As soon as this exception makes some sense for you, right, to understand the error.
Yes.
So similarly, Java has many such exceptions in its own library. Okay, it has many such exceptions. So whenever we, like said, divided by zero, if you do, and it goes to infinity, it will give you the divided by zero error. It holds many such exceptions. So whenever we went through those errors, it will print there. Okay, these exceptions, we have a separate session for that. It will not come now. Maybe it will take another 1 or 2 weeks actually to come there exceptions. Okay, till there, you just you just know that there will be some errors which will be thrown, and it will be handled by Java exception classes. Okay. And ternary operators, we'll just complete it today. You guys are okay to extend it another 5 minutes, right?
Okay,
we have already started delayed by 10 minutes. So we'll just extend for another 5 minutes so that we'll be able to cover that 10 minutes time. So Harsha, can you just ping here your program that you have written? Ternary operators are simple guys. See what I have done here. Let's say int. I equal to 5. Int I equal to 5. Int x equal to, ternary operators mostly we'll use it. See, usually you'll use if condition while doing the condition check, right? But there are some times you need to check the condition to put some value in a variable. Those times you will use the ternary operators. Let's say Java ternary operator. Where did I take the example? See here. If n1 equal to 5, n2 equal to 10, and then it is a result. Here what it is doing, if this result value I need to store based on the condition, the variable value I need to get based on the condition. So if n1 is greater than n2, this is the condition, okay? Then n1 plus n2, I need to have this variable. Okay, let's take this sample. We'll come back to the program. Okay, sorry, let's do the debug. See, now n1 is 5, n2 is 10. There is another variable called result. Okay, now I'm printing n1 and I'm printing n2. Second number is n2. So in the result variable, I haven't initialized with any value, right?
No.
Yes.
So result value, I need to come up with depending on this one. See, if n1 is greater than n2, 5 is greater than 10, it failed, right?
Yes.
Then 5 plus 10. I mean to get 15. Yes. Otherwise, 5 minus 10. I should get minus 5.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Otherwise, and then.
What is that?
That question mark.
Okay, this is the syntax. See, this is the similar to if condition, but this ternary operators usually will use it to place something in a variables and all. Like what you do it if condition
statement
else statement. Right here you do the statements, right?
Yes.
Similarly, this is the syntax for this, guys. Ternary operators. If this is the condition here, n greater than n2, okay, this becomes the condition. Okay, this is this braces. If this condition satisfies, this will be the state. These are the statements. This is else, fails. This is the statements. Okay, yeah. Simple. Condition pass. Condition
fails.
So if this condition passes, next to this question mark will be executed. If this condition failed, next to this colon will be executed. So colon is your else statements. This is your if condition statements. Okay.
Okay.
Very simple. Let's see now. We just change it now. N1 is 10. N2 is 5. Okay, what will be the output now?
15. N1 plus N2.
Correct. N1 plus N2. Okay. Result stores. If this condition satisfies, result stores this value.
Yeah, the N1 plus
okay. If it is failed, result stores
N1 minus N2.
N1 minus N2. Okay. If I just run it, I'll get 15 now. Clear, guys? Very simple. 15. You're good about ternary operators. So when you're assigning some variable, see, you need to derive a value to this variable based on some conditions. Then you will go for ternary operators doing if conditions and all. So different languages like different operators like C#, we use IFF. Okay, something like that. That is ternary operators for if condition. So something like that, it will be there. Okay, but in Java, you use it by question mark and colon. Understood, guys?
Yes.
Sure, guys. We're all good, right, for today's thing? We completed a for loop, and we started already discussing about arrays, which stores the multiple values. We have also seen that array length, what is array length, and how the values will be stored in an index. We have seen that. Okay. What else did we cover? Extended for loop. I'll be covering it tomorrow. You'll be able to apply it with anything. Okay. From tomorrow, we'll again start with extended for loop, and we'll see a good program for arrays tomorrow. We'll just write a small program which will, you know, we'll take a candidate, his name from the command line, his name from the his subjects from the command line, and his marks from the command line, and we'll do the small arithmetic program, and we'll display the progress report in the command line itself with arrays. Okay, tomorrow we'll do that program. You guys are with me?
Yeah.
Okay, so what is the exercise for you for tomorrow?
Bring the Fibonacci series.
Okay, just complete with that. Okay, and if you do some other programming also, there are many other things, guys, because even I go to the programming Java point to get you some good examples. Okay, now I went to Pyramid. I thought, like, even I was learning Pyramid is something that everywhere we keep on learning. Now here, if you see, there is one more program here. Int I equal to 1, I less than or equal to 3. See, you're able to see my screen, right?
Yes.
See, this is outer loop. inner loop, j equal to 1, j less than. Here I haven't given the I again. So outer loop is repeating for 3 times. Inner loop is repeating it for 3 times. Okay. But for inner loop, if I equal to equal to 2 and I j equal to equal to 3, I'm using break statement. That is the reason outer loop, see when I'm doing the print here, 1, I is 1, j is 1, you know, this condition, when I is 1, j is 1, this condition will not satisfy, right?
Yes.
I'm printing I and j, I space j. Okay. Then again, the second loop. As I said, for loop will repeat for 3 times. This for loop will repeat for 3 times. So again, I is still 1, j becomes 2. Again, I 1, j 2, still fail. So 1, 2 printed. Again, I 1, j becomes 3. This condition still failed. So 1, 3 also printed. Now, again, it goes there in top. Second, I becomes now 2. Come back here. Now I is 2. Here again, J will start, for loop will start freshly. J will start 1. Again, it failed. Okay. So you go to Java point. There are a lot of examples, guys. You will be able to do it. Maybe you try this program. Okay. 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1, 3, 1, 3, 2, 3, 3. I'll ping you in the group. Okay. You try this program also so that effectively you will be able to understand multiple the nested for loops. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, guys. So I guess we're done for today. Okay. Please do, as your guys are already doing great, please do practice. Now that you are into for loop and then you are getting into arrays, this is where actually you need more and more practice. Okay. Should write the Fibonacci series and also this 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3 and 2, 1, 2, 3, 2, 2, 3, 3. Do this program also. Okay. If I find any interesting programs, I'll also ping you in the group. Keep practicing those as well. Okay.
Okay.
Sure. Sure. We're done with the day. Have a great day, guys. See you tomorrow. Bye.
Thank you.
Pina, you can record it, Pina.
Hello, Anna, chapanna.
Pina, record chestha, Pina.